بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. Then Al-Hafidh rahimahullah said, Kitab al-Jihad, the book of Jihad. This is the verbal noun of the Arabic verb jahada, yujahidu, which means to strive or struggle, to do something which is normally hard to accomplish. And in the technical terminology, when we talk about jihad, then this is to expend your energy to fight the kuffar or those Muslims who rebel against the ruler or those people in the Muslim state who cause mischief and corruption on the land, like the highwaymen or groups of bandits and so on. So it is to strive against all of these three categories. The ruling on al-jihad is that it is legislated from the Quran, from the Sunnah and the Ijma of the scholars. There are a superfluous number of narrations and ayat talking about the obligation of jihad, or at least the fact that it's legislated, and also talking about its virtues. And before we delve into the rulings and regulations of al-jihad, let us put in a word about what the kuffar have to say about this jihad, because the popular line which is spread amongst them, particularly amongst the Christians, it seems to be their favorite line, is that Islam spread by the sword and it forced people to convert to Islam or die. And this type of claim, either this will arise out of pure ignorance, so maybe a non-Muslim hears other non-Muslims speak about this, and he believes what he hears, without doing any particular research. So he's just plain ignorant and that's it. Or this type of claim could come about through people who have a grudge against Islam and who have a hatred. And this is perfectly understandable. Every time you have guidance or people of guidance, you're going to have certain other people who hate the guidance or people of guidance. And this has been happening since the beginning of man. So in reply to this, we say that the objective of jihad is not to force anybody to convert. The Muslim army does not care who converts, who does not convert. This is not the objective of jihad, neither was it ever the objective of jihad. The objective of jihad is to make the word of Allah superior in the land. This basically means that the law belongs to Allah Jalla wa Ala in the land. So the land must be ruled by Islamic law. Now this is very well possible where most of the people in the land are kuffar. This is the ultimate aim. It is not to convert people to Islam. So we find if the kuffar would pay the jizya and live under the Islamic law, then no Muslim soldier is allowed to touch them. So the purpose of jihad is not to force convert anybody into Islam. That's the first point to note. The second point to note is that, just think about this, is it even possible to force somebody to convert to any ideology? At best, you can show him the sword or show him the gun, and he will say, yes, I accept your religion. But this is not accepting your religion. This is simply giving it the lip service. You only ever accept a particular ideology because your heart accepts it. And it is well known that it is literally impossible to convert anyone's heart or to force convert somebody's heart into accepting something. If something is not to his liking, it is not to his liking. And there is literally nothing you can do about this. If, for example, someone does not like to eat anchovies because he simply does not like the taste, are you now able to make him enjoy anchovies? Absolutely not. Yes, you can force feed him, that's true, but you cannot force him to like anchovies. So this is the issue with conversion. You can force him to say that he converts in terms of his lip service, but you cannot force him to accept Islam. But the point is, if somebody just says the Shahada to save his life, then this is not Islam. It is not accepted by Allah Jalla wa Ala, and every Muslim knows this. So if that's the case, then what would be the point or the benefit in the Muslim soldier force converting a non-Muslim to Islam? It is literally impossible. So what these Christians accuse the Muslim army of doing is they accuse them of performing an act which is literally impossible to perform. To force convert somebody to your ideology is about as possible as making a four-sided triangle. So that argument is just rationally putting it forward. We also have texts from the Quran as well, Allah Jalla wa Ala saying, لا إكراه في الدين قد تبين الرشد من الغي فمن يكفر بالطاغوت ويؤمن بالله فقد استمسك بالعروة الوثقى لَمْ فِصَامَ لَهَا وَاللَّهُ سَمِيعٌ عَلِيمٌ. There can be no compulsion in the deen. So you cannot force anyone to accept this deen, because the truth has become clear and manifest from the falsehood. So whoever makes kufr or rejects the false gods and has iman in Allah, then he has held on to the trustworthy handle that will never split, and Allah is the hearer, the knowledgeable. That is the famous ayah in Surah Al-Baqarah. There is another one in Surah Yunus. Allah Jalla wa Ala says, وَلَوْ شَاءَ رَبُّكَ لَآمَنَ مَنْ فِي الْأَرْضِ كُلُّهُمْ جَمِيعًا أَفَأَنْتَ تُكْرِهُ النَّاسَ حَتَّى يَكُونُوا مُؤْمِنِينَ وَمَا كَانَ لِنَفْسٍ أَنْ تُؤْمِنَ إِلَّا بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ وَيَجْعَلُ الرِّجْسَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ لَا يَعْقِلُونَ. And if your Lord had willed, everybody on earth would have believed. So are you going to force the people that they become believers? It is not for any soul to believe or have iman except by the permission of Allah, and He will put the punishment on those people who do not use their intellect. So clearly we find from both of these ayat that it is not possible nor permissible to force anyone to convert to this deen. And this is never the objective of jihad. The objective of jihad is that the ruling belongs to Allah Jalla wa Ala, that's it. And as for the obligation of jihad, then this is clear enough. If the Muslims do not fight and take over the land, it will be the kuffar who take over the Muslim land. But either way, somebody is going to be on top. Either the Muslims are on top, or the kuffar are on top. So if the Muslims stop fighting, the kuffar will be on top. So from here then, the Muslim has a choice to make. Which one would he prefer? And so we say that the times when Islam grew fastest in terms of the people embracing Islam was not during times of war, it was during times of peace. And what clearly demonstrates this, or at least goes some way to demonstrating this, is that nowadays, in the year 2013, in the common era, we have many non-Muslims in kuffar countries converting to Islam. Now we have to ask, which Muslim army is forcing them to convert? No, rather they convert because they research this deen, they find out about it, and not just merely listen to kuffar propaganda. They actually research this deen, and they find that it strikes a chord with them. And this is the truth which they were searching for all along. This is how people convert. Conversion is when your heart converts, not when your tongue merely blurts out certain words. So we find that the reality contradicts these evil and false claims which the enemies of Al-Islam make. The other point to note is that they say that Islam oppresses women. But then we ask them the immediate question, how is it that most of the converts who are converting to Islam from non-Islam are women? Why would a woman want to convert to this religion or this deen which clearly oppresses women? Are all of those women crazy? And so this is something they will not find an answer, except to say perhaps she's doing it because of marriage purposes. Well, that's wrong. Reality tells us otherwise. They convert because they have researched this deen and their heart has converted. They do not do it for any marriage purpose. But even if it was for marriage purpose, then still the question remains, why would you want to convert to a religion which oppresses women, even if it is for the sake of marriage? Why would you ever want to convert to such a religion for any reason? Just perhaps the answer may be that this deen does not oppress women. No, rather it is in tune with the natural fitrah of the woman, which is the natural goodness and the natural knowledge of Allah Jalla wa Ala, which every human being has. What about the virtues of jihad? Does it have any virtues? Well, actually, this topic of the virtue of jihad is a whole lecture in and of itself, because there is just so much material in terms of the Quranic ayat and the ahadith. But let us just quickly quote a couple here, just to give ourselves the idea of the virtue of al-jihad. So, for example, in the famous hadith where Ibn Abbas asked the Prophet ﷺ what will take him out of the fire and put him in Jannah, the Prophet replied with all the main obligations which are upon him. And then at the end of the hadith, he says that the ذَرْوَةُ سَنَامِهِ الْجِهَادُ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ, that the peak of this hump of Islam is jihad. And also in Sahih Muslim, from An-Nu'man ibn Bashir, he says that I was at the minbar of the Prophet ﷺ when a man said, مَا أُبَالِي أَلَّا أَعْمَلَ عَمَلًا بعد الإسلام إلا أن أسقي الحاج. I do not care if I don't do any other action after my Islam, except that I should give water to those performing the Hajj. And in response, another man said, ما أبالي أن لا أعمل عملا بعد الإسلام إلا أن أعمر المسجد الحرام. I do not care if I don't do anything else after my Islam, except populating the المسجد الحرام, meaning always remaining in there. And in response to that, a third man came along and he said, الجهاد في سبيل الله أفضل مما قلتم. That making jihad in the way of Allah is better than everything both of you have said. And so in response to this, Umar ibn al-Khattab came and he prevented them from having this discussion. He said to them, لا ترفعوا أصواتكم عند منبر رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وهو يوم الجمعة. He said, don't raise your voices near the minbar of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, and it is يوم الجمعة as well. ولكن إذا صليت الجمعة دخلت فاستفتيت فيما اختلفتم فيه. But rather, when I finish praying the Jumu'ah, I will enter in upon the Prophet and will ask him about that which you are arguing or differing over. And so he did that, and in response, Allah Jalla wa'ala revealed the ayah in Surah At-Tawbah, ayah 19. أَجَعَلْتُمْ سِقَايَةَ الْحَاجِّ وَعِمَارَةَ الْمَسْجِدِ الْحَرَامِ كَمَنْ آمَنَ بِاللَّهِ واليوم الآخر وجاهد في سبيل الله لا يستوون عند الله والله لا يهدي القوم الظالمين. Do you think that giving water to the Hujjaj to drink or spending time in the Masjid al-Haram is the same as the one who has Iman in Allah and the Last Day and he strives in the way of Allah? They are not equal with Allah, and Allah does not guide the wrongdoers. He goes on in the surah, الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَهَاجَرُوا وَجَاهَدُوا فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ بِأَمْوَالِهِمْ وَأَنفُسِهِمْ أَعْظَمُ دَرَجَةً عِنْدَ اللَّهِ وَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْفَائِزُونَ. Those who have Iman and they made hijrah and they made jihad in the way of Allah with their wealth and their lives, they are greater in status with Allah and they are the successful ones. يُبَشِّرُهُمْ رَبُّهُمْ بِرَحْمَةٍ مِّنْهُ وَرِضْوَانٍ وَجَنَّاتٍ لَهُمْ فِيهَا نَعِيمٌ مُقِيمٌ. Their Lord gives them glad tidings of mercy from Him, and He is pleased with Him, and glad tidings of gardens for them, in which there is everlasting delight. خَالِدِينَ فِيهَا أَبَدًا إِنَّ اللَّهَ عِنْدَهُ أَجْرٌ عَظِيمٌ. Dwelling therein forever, verily, with Allah is a great reward. To put it quite simply, if it wasn't for al-jihad fi sabilillah, the kuffar will gain authority over the Muslims, take them in as slaves, change their deen, and there would be no Muslims to carry on this deen to the next and succeeding generations. And we would find that today, in this day and age, nobody would be a Muslim. So jihad is there to defend the deen of al-Islam from being eradicated. It may seem unthinkable until you actually think about it. So, to sum up, jihad in the technical definition is to fight to make the word of Allah the superior. However, people often talk about other types of jihad as well, like the jihad al-nafs, the striving against the self. This does not really have a discussion in the books of fiqh, this is more like purification of the soul. But the jihad al-nafs is simply when you strive against yourself to obey Allah Jalla wa'ala. Remember, your own self orders you to do evil often. As we find in the Qur'an, إِنَّ النَّفْسَ لَأَمَّارَةٌ بِالسُّوءِ إِلَّا مَا رَحِمَ رَبِّي إِنَّ رَبِّي غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ. Verily, the soul orders to do evil except upon whom Allah has mercy. Verily, my Lord is forgiving the merciful. And at times, obeying Allah Jalla wa'ala can be extremely difficult. Or for example, leaving off which Allah has prohibited can be extremely difficult. And people vary in this, so everybody is required to strive against the self. People often quote the hadith where the Prophet ﷺ returned from the expedition of Tabuk and he is reported to have said, رَجَعْنَا مِنَ الْجِهَادِ الْأَصْغَرِ إِلَى الْجِهَادِ الْأَكْبَرِ. We have returned from the lesser jihad to the greater jihad, the lesser jihad being the fighting and the greater jihad being the striving against the soul, meaning forcing yourself to obey Allah Jalla wa Ala. However, this hadith is weak, and even in its meaning it's weak, because fighting against the kuffar is not the lesser jihad. In fact, it is the greatest possible jihad. Any other type of jihad is lesser. But nevertheless, the jihad of nafs, striving against the soul, this concept certainly does exist, and it is from the purification of the soul. There is another type of jihad, which is the jihad against the munafiqeen. And this does not necessarily involve fighting, because the munafiqeen in the Muslim community, who outwardly display their Islam, but inwardly they are not, they are not fought. And there were many munafiqeen during the time of the Prophet ﷺ, right in Al-Madinah. And the Prophet forbade that they should be killed or fought, and he justified it by saying, حَتَّى لَا يَتَحَدَّثَ النَّاسُ أَنَّ مُحَمَّدًا يَقْتُلُ أَصْحَابَهُ, so that the people don't start saying amongst themselves that Muhammad kills his own companions. Because if this is the predominant thought in the minds of the people, then who would want to convert to Islam? So they are not necessarily fought, but they can still have jihad made against them. Allah Jalla wa Ala says, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّبِيُّ جَاهِدِ الْكُفَّارَ وَالْمُنَافِقِينَ وَاغْلُظْ عَلَيْهِمْ وَمَأْوَاهُمْ جَهَنَّمُ وَبِئْسَ الْمَصِيرُ. O Prophet, make jihad against the kuffar and the munafiqeen, and be severe against them. Their dwelling place is Jahannam, and what an evil destination that is. So how are the munafiqeen to be made jihad against? It is made against them with the tongue. Jihad does not have to take place with the sword or with military weapons. Sometimes the best weapon you have is your tongue and your knowledge. And the tongue is the best weapon for them, because the game which the munafiqeen play is that normally they spread shubuhat amongst the Muslimin. They will try to make certain things halal which are haram. And they will try to justify it, of course, using the Quran, using the Sunnah, using whatever means they can to make people follow their desires and to change the deen of Islam. So they are different to the kuffar, because at least with the kuffar you know where they stand. They are outright kuffar. They want to fight the Muslims. And the relationship is far clearer. With the munafiqeen is a little more fuzzy, because they're outwardly displaying their Islam, but secretly they're trying to change it, distort it, and dilute it. So they are throwing an intellectual attack against Islam, so you reply intellectually, with your tongue, with knowledge, with wisdom. But when it comes to fiqh, then our discussion is about the jihad against the kuffar, and this would be the military jihad. Okay, so the first question is, what is the ruling on this jihad? We say it is fardu kifaya. So there must be a group of people who perform it. Basically, the number needs to be enough to get the job done. So clearly one or two is not going to be enough. But at the same time, the whole community is not required to join in this act. Allah Jalla wa Ala says, مَا كَانَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ لِيَنْفِرُوا كَافَّ. It is not for the believers to all go out in fighting altogether. He tells us there should be some people remaining in the city so they could learn the knowledge and teach the other soldiers when they return. However, we do have a condition here. The condition is that the Muslims have the ability and the military strength to perform this jihad. This is a vital condition, because otherwise this is not jihad if you just go out unprepared. Rather, this is foolishness, and the Sharia does not order foolishness. Allah Jalla wa Ala says, فَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ مَا اسْتَطَعْتُمْ. Fear Allah as much as you are able to. But if you don't have the military might, then you're not able to perform the jihad, and there is no blame upon you. Likewise, he tells us, وَأَعِدُّ لَهُمْ مَا اسْتَطَعْتُمْ مِنْ قُوَّةٍ, and prepare for them whatever you can of strength. So if you don't have the strength and military might, then it is not an obligation to go out and fight, because this would be foolishness, it would not be jihad. So this is the general asl, or the original ruling with jihad, is that it is fardu kifaya. However, in certain scenarios, it could become fardu ayn upon you, meaning an individual obligation upon you. So we have four cases in which this could be. Number one, when you are actually present in the fighting and the two armies, they meet each other. At this particular point, you don't have a choice to turn back. You have to fight. So anyone who is present at this stage of the game, he must continue. The evidence for this, Allah Jalla wa Ala saying, يا أيها الذين آمنوا إذا لقيتم الذين كفروا زحفا فلا تولوهم الأدبار. Oh, you who believe, when you meet the kuffar as you are marching forward, then you must not turn your backs to them. وَمَنْ يُوَلِّهِمْ يَوْمَئِذٍ دُبْرَهُ إِلَّا مُتَحَرِّفًا لِقِتَالٍ أَوْ مُتَحِيِّزًا إِلَى فِئَةٍ فَقَدْ بَاءَ بِغَضَبٍ مِّنَ اللَّهِ وَمَأْوَاهُ جَهَنَّمُ وَبِئْسَ الْمَصِيرُ. And whoever turns his back that day, then he has descended upon the anger of Allah, and his dwelling place is Jahannam, and what an evil destination that is, except for the one who flees as a strategy of war, so as to fool the kuffar into thinking that he's fleeing away, whereas in fact he's not, he's planning a counterattack. Or if he is fleeing from one group of Muslim fighters to another group to help them out. So this is one evidence from the Quran. We have another one from the authentic hadith. The Prophet ﷺ ordered his companions to refrain or avoid the seven major sins, those which destroy. And from them, he mentioned At-tawalli yawm al-zahf, turning your back and fleeing on the day when you're marching to the enemy. The exception for turning away, as given in the ayah, are two. Firstly, you run away, but your intention is to come back with greater strength. So it's not like running away and that's it. Rather, you are going to come back, but with greater strength and launch a greater attack. So that's fine. The second exception is if you go to join another group of the Muslim army to help them out, perhaps they are about to be defeated. But this is on the condition that the group you are leaving does not seriously need you, such that if you leave them, they will be defeated. So you need to note that condition. The second time in which it becomes fardhu ayn is if the kuffar invade your country. So this would be the jihad of the defense. And this, in fact, is very similar then to the first scenario where the two sides meet each other. Because here, when the kuffar have invaded your land, then the two sides have met each other. Allah Jalla wa Ala says in Surah At-Tawbah, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا قَاتِلُوا الَّذِينَ يَلُونَكُم مِّنَ الْكُفَّارِ وَلْيَجِدُوا فِيكُمْ غِلْظَةً وَاعْلَمُوا أَنَّ اللَّهَ مَعَ الْمُتَّقِينَ. O believers, fight those of the kuffar who are close to you, and let them find harshness in you, and know that Allah is with the muttaqeen. So these kuffar who are close to you, meaning they have invaded your country. It doesn't just mean any kafir who is friendly to you, or who is living under an Islamic state. No, not just any kafir, but the one who has invaded your country, the harbi, meaning the one who is at war with you. And the third scenario, when the imam tells you to move out and to fight. So if he specifies you, then it becomes fardhu ayn upon you. The evidence for this, the Prophet ﷺ saying, وَإِذَا اسْتُنْفِرْتُمْ فَانْفِرُوا. And when you are asked to march, then march out. Likewise in the Qur'an, Allah Jalla wa Ala says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مَا لَكُمْ إِذَا قِيلَ لَكُمُ انْفِرُوا فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ فَقَلْتُمْ إِلَى الْأَرْضِ أَرَضِيتُمْ بِالْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا مِنَ الْآخِرَةِ فَمَا مَتَاعُ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا فِي الْآخِرَةِ إِلَّا قَلِيلٌ إِلَّا تَنْفِرُوا يُعَذِّبُكُمْ عَذَابًا أَلِيمًا وَيَسْتَبْدِلْ قَوْمًا غَيْرَكُمْ وَلَا تَضُرُّوهُ شَيْئًا وَاللَّهُ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٌ. Oh, you believe, what is the matter with you? When you are told to march out, you cling heavily to the earth. Are you content with this world over the hereafter? But the enjoyment of this world is only very small compared to the hereafter. If you do not march out, Allah will punish you a painful torment and will exchange you with another people, and you will not harm Allah in aught. And Allah is able to do all things. The fourth occasion, it could be fardhu kifayah, is if you are the only person who knows how to work a particular piece of technology which others don't, and this technology is needed in the war. So here, we have no choice, it becomes fardhu ayn upon you. And then, after all of that, we say that al-jihad can be made with the wealth as well. In fact, in most of the ayat in which Allah talks about jihad, He talks about the jihad of the wealth and then of the self. And the reason for that is clear enough, because making jihad with your wealth, giving it to the cause of fighting, This is easier to do than to actually give your own self, your own body, to the cause of fighting. So you could have a person who may not be able to make jihad with his own body, but he has wealth, so he ought to spend his wealth in that way as well. Because this is also something that Allah Jalla wa Ala instructs the Muslims to do. And also coming under the topic of jihad is this idea of ribat. Ribat, coming from rabata, which means to tie something. And what we mean here is that a person guards the boundaries of the Muslim land. It could be that the Imam fears that the kafir are about to launch an attack. And this could happen at any time now. Maybe he has some military intelligence which tells him this. So he will deploy some soldiers to guard the boundary of the Muslim land. And this is al-ribat. And the virtue of this is great. In Sahih Muslim, the Prophet ﷺ said, رِبَاطُ يَوْمٍ وَلَيْلَةٍ خَيْرٌ مِنْ صِيَامِ شَهْرٍ وَقِيَامِهِ وَإِمْ مَاتَ أُجْرِيَ عَلَيْهِ عَمَلُهُ الَّذِي كَانَ يَعْمَلُهُ وَأُجْرِيَ عَلَيْهِ رِزْقُهُ وَأُمِنَ الْفِتَانِ. That making ribat for one day and night is better than 1 month of fasting and praying. And if he was to die in this state, then his good deeds which he used to perform would continue to run, meaning he would continue to receive its reward, and he would continue to receive his rizq, or his provision, and he will be safe from the fitna. So you can see the immense reward here of ribat for just one day and night. Another important issue to note is that before marching out, it is upon the imam or the leader of the army to have a look at the army he has. And he must prevent those people who will be a liability. Because if the wrong type of people march out, then they could be the cause for your army losing. We know what happened in the Battle of Uhud, where just a small group of people disobeyed the Prophet and the whole army lost. So just small groups of people can make a difference. And so the Imam would prevent anyone who discourages the other Muslims from fighting. He is not to partake in the army. Or anyone the Imam feels will be detrimental for the morale of the army. Or perhaps somebody who has his mind focused or set on other things other than fighting for the sake of Allah. For example, in the hadith in Sahih Muslim, the Prophet reports that from the prophets who were from the bygone era, a prophet marched out with his army and he told the people marching with him, لا يتبعني رجل قد ملك بضع امرأة وهو يريد أن يبني بها ولما يبني ولا آخر قد بنى بنيانا ولما يرفع سقفها ولا آخر قد اشترى غنما أو خليفات وهو منتظر ولادها. He says that the person who has just married a woman but has not consummated marriage and he wants to consummate the marriage, then this type of man must not follow me in this war, nor the person who has built a house but he has not made its roof yet, nor the person who has bought a sheep or a camel and he's waiting for the animal to give birth. So he said that these three types of people are not to join the army. Why is this? The reason should be clear, because their mind will be set on these other affairs back in their home city. And so if that's the case, this will distract them from the war, they will not be able to fully focus, and they will actually be a liability rather than an asset. Or perhaps you could have somebody who is not in a positive frame of mind, or somebody who is just negative in life. So he might cause fear amongst the other Muslims, or his negativity may spread like a contagious disease amongst other Muslims. So he might say something like, oh, there was an army which set out before us to fight these particular kuffar, and they suffered a heavy loss. So there's not much chance of us succeeding, or that this army is extremely powerful. This endeavor of ours is not going to bear any fruits. This type of negative rubbish attitude has no place in the Muslim army, because these people are losers, and losers have no place in the rows of the mujahideen. So this is the obligation upon the imam. The obligation upon the rest of the army is very simple. Listen and obey. The moment the army or even parts of the army starts to dispute or starts to oppose the order because they don't like it for whatever reason, then this will lead to the defeat of the Muslims. Allah Jalla wa Ala makes this immensely clear in the Quran, where he says, وأطيعوا الله ورسوله ولا تنازعوا فتفشلوا وتذهب ريحكم واصبروا إن الله مع الصابرين. And obey Allah and His Messenger, and do not dispute with one another, lest you lose courage and your strength departs. And be patient, verily Allah is with those who are patient. So if your imam tells you to do something which you don't like, then you have to learn to bite the bullet, you have to learn to take it on the chin, and you have to learn to do something which you simply don't like, for the sake of unity, for the sake of victory. So we find here that disputes and argumentation leads to you losing courage, which in turn leads to you losing your strength, which in turn leads to you losing the battle. And the general rule is, for all Muslims, that they obey the ruler as long as he does not tell them to commit a sin against Allah Jalla wa Ala. But what we are concerned with here is matters of strategy of war. So if he tells you a particular strategy, then you obey him and you do not argue. And also know that these ayat talking about the ghazwa or the military expedition, they are directed to the leaders of the Muslims. Thus, if a Muslim wants to join a military expedition, he has to do so by the permission of the Imam. So in other words, you have to gain the approval. Except it be the case that the kuffar attack the Muslim land and then the jihad becomes fardu ayn,
then you do not need to seek the approval. Okay, let's take some review questions. Question number one. Explain what jihad is linguistically and technically. Question number two. Explain the ruling on fleeing when the battle breaks out and state any exceptions to the general rule. Question number three. State what we mean by ribat in the fiqhi sense and then state its virtue.